Hello, my name is Emily Cabasash, and I'm about to present you with an immersive 3D walking tour of Rome, Italy. This tour combines the worlds of history, art, architecture, food, fashion, and geographic information systems to provide a quick but incredible glimpse at one of the most influential cities in the history of mankind. This tour is designed for a 12-hour day beginning at 8 a.m. and ending at 8 p.m. A total of 9 hours were spent touring, with the duration of each stop detailed in this video. There are a total of 4 miles of walking that will take about 2 hours to complete, leaving 2 additional hours for lunch and dinner. Time management is key to completing the full tour in one day, but for travelers with more time, feel free to split the trip into 2 or 3 days. There are 9 major stops on this tour, starting at the Vatican City and ending at the Colosseum. Along the way, I will be mentioning, as well as pointing out on the map, locations of places that are top-rated in their area by experienced travelers from multiple traveling websites to ensure an overall quality experience in the Eternal City. In the bottom right-hand corner, you will find the actual walking directions to arrive at each destination. This brings us to our first stop, the Vatican City. Constructed on the site where Peter the Apostle is believed to have been crucified and buried, the Vatican City was established in 1929 as an independent state. The first site you will see of the Vatican is St. Peter's Square, or Piazza San Pietro, a keyhole-shaped square surrounded by 284 Doric columns, 4 in each row, creating a spectacular set of colonnades. The colonnade itself was designed by Gian Lorenzo Bernini, a Baroque sculptor whose work we will be witnessing several times along this journey. The back of the square, you will witness the largest basilica in the world, St. Peter's. Topped by Michelangelo's dome, and with columns standing 90 feet high, this grand basilica may be entered for free on the right side of the square. Inside, you will find Michelangelo's Pieta, the tomb of John Paul II, the statue of St. Peter, a papal altar also by Bernini, the entrance to the top of the dome costing 7 euros, and many more invaluable treasures from Christianity. The Vatican Museums lie on the right side of the square, along with the papal apartments, the Sistine Chapel, and multiple administrative buildings. The Vatican Museums contain 11 individual museums, most notably the Raphael Rooms, the Sistine Chapel, and the Etruscan Museum, with tickets costing 18 euros. Several days can be spent meandering the museum, but today only 3 hours are allocated to be spent in the entirety of the Vatican. As the smallest state in the world, the Vatican City is home to merely 800 residents, living in just over 100 acres, most of which are dedicated priests and nuns of the Christian faith, as well as the Pope himself. This city is a collection of artwork and history accumulated over centuries, and in some cases, millennia. I would not be surprised if some of you end your tour of Rome here. We will begin our 4-mile journey by walking down Via della Cooperazione towards Castel Sant'Angelo and the Tiber River. The Tiber River runs 252 miles long and meanders throughout Rome, once being a major flood hazard. Rome was once level with the river, and it would occasionally flood and destroy large parts of the city. Some have said that the biggest enemy of Rome in the past has been the Tiber because of this. However, today one can see that the city has compensated by raising the entire ground level of Rome tens of feet. When walking by, imagine the same buildings you see standing at the base of the embankments around the river, and you can imagine Rome as it was in ancient times. You have 1.5 hour at your second stop, Castel Sant'Angelo, or Castle of the Holy Angel, which sits just 10 minutes from the Vatican City on the famed Tiber River of Rome. Construction originally began in 123 AD as the tomb of the Roman Emperor Hadrian, who reigned from 117 to 138. Since then, Castel Sant'Angelo has seen many alternate uses. In early 400 AD, the tomb was converted into a fortress, and much of the original features were destroyed. Late in the 13th century, a member of the powerful Orsini family in Rome, and owner of Castel Sant'Angelo, selected Pope Nicholas III. He later developed the Passetto, or passage connecting the Vatican City and Castel Sant'Angelo through a tunnel in a hidden aqueduct, as well as a chapel to St. Michael at the top of the fortress. Under the possession of the popes, a papal residence was constructed, along with a prison where executions were held, defensive towers, and a moat. Crossing Ponte Sant'Angelo, we are now headed towards Piazza Navona. Narrow Cafe lies just across the bridge on the right-hand side, and just past there lies Gelateria degli Artisti and Via di Panico, if you feel so inclined to have some sweets along our walk. And Via de Carnari lies another gelateria, Gelateria del Teatro. Halfway up on the left and further ahead stands Spazio If, a highly rated antique store. Up ahead there are more shops that will be pointed out on the map. Di San Giacomo Gioielli, a shoe store, Too Much, another home decor store, Society, a linen store, and Strategic Business Unit, a well-rated clothing store. A lively square night and day, Piazza Navona is an excellent location to grab a bite to eat and peruse around the local shops and art vendors in the square. Tre Scalini and Grom are both excellent locations to grab some gelato, and there's a wide selection of restaurants for lunch. Don't be afraid to venture down the side streets behind the piazza in search of a more intimate dining experience. Navona La Sorgente is an excellent bookstore opposite the Baroque facade of Borromini's Santa Agnes in Argonne, a church constructed in the 17th century commissioned by the papacy. The square itself is built directly upon the Stadium of Domitian, constructed around 80 AD, which now lies over 20 feet below ground level. Central to the life of Piazza Navona are the three major fountains, Fontana del Moro, Fontana del Nettuno, and Fontana dei Quattro Fiumi. All Baroque-style fountains, Fontana dei Quattro Fiumi, or Fountain of the Four Rivers, is the most significant and grandiose. Designed by Bernini and once again topped by an ancient Egyptian obelisk, the fountain represents four major rivers on four different continents: the Nile, the Danube, the Ganges, and the Rio de la Plata. An hour is allotted for your time here in Piazza Navona. However, if you choose to use your lunch hour here, the total time can be 2 hours. The walk to the Pantheon is only about 5 minutes, but you will pass Palazzo Madama along the way, the Senate of the Italian government. One street over from our path is Piazza di San Eustachio, where a famous cafe lies with the same name. I recommend straying off the path to find it if time allows. Standing 142 feet high, you will be amazed that this imposing building is capable of hiding so well in plain sight. Nestled into a small square, the Pantheon dominates your view from every angle, as if commanding you to appreciate its architectural accomplishments and societal significance. Built by Emperor Hadrian in 125 AD as a pagan temple and dedicated to Marcus Agrippa, it was converted into a church 500 years later and is home to the tombs of Raphael the Artist and Vittorio Emmanuel, the first king of unified Italy in 1861. Free to enter, the Pantheon's dome is the largest unsupported dome from ancient times, and Michelangelo himself used this dome as a guide for the dome of St. Peter's Basilica. Crawford's ceiling is designed to counteract optical illusions causing the space to seem smaller, and was once decorated brilliantly in bronze. The oculus at the center of the dome is an engineering feat in itself, being the largest of its kind. Every detail of the Pantheon was carefully planned out and executed to perfection, affording us the ability to witness this ancient architectural achievement. The side streets around the Pantheon, especially to the left of the facade, also provide a multitude of gift shops you can browse. Only half an hour can be spent at the Pantheon before continuing to our next stop. Our longest walk of the day between stops is to the Spanish Steps. For those who are capable of taking more time to see the city, past the Spanish Steps is Villa Borghese, including the Borghese Gardens and Borghese Gallery. Villa Medici is also in its vicinity. These are beautiful places to stop if you have more time and allow for a break from the busy city atmosphere. Also of note, on the way to the Spanish Steps, we will be walking down Rome's most fashionable street, Via del Condotti. This street has shops from some of the world's most well-known designers and brands, including Armani, Louis Vuitton, Dolce & Gabbana, Prada, Gucci, Ferrari, Fendi, Hermes, and more. It also has one of Rome's most famous cafes, Café Greco, which originally opened in 1760, making it over 250 years old and the oldest cafe in Rome. This extravagant staircase was constructed in 1723 to connect the French church Trinità dei Monti to the square below it. At the foot of the Spanish Steps lies Fontana della Baraccia, or the Fountain of the Ugly Boat, sculpted by Bernini and his father in 1598 in remembrance of the devastating flood that occurred that same year. The fountain depicts a boat which appears to be sinking into the clean, crystal-clear water that it spouts from deep bedrock aquifers. The staircase itself is made up of 137 steps in 12 separate flights, with Trinità dei Monti at its summit. You have half an hour with the spectacular view of Rome from the top of the stairs, which includes Michelangelo's dome in the distance and the cloud of shoppers on Via del Condotti. We are now on our way to the Trevi Fountain. All around the city of Rome, you might find yourself reading the acronym SPQR on everything from manholes to public buildings. This is an abbreviation for a Latin phrase meaning the Senate and the people of Rome. This phrase has been used since ancient times and is still used in the modern day to unify and symbolize the people of Rome. Another common symbol that you will encounter on this trip is that of a wolf nursing two babies. This relates to the ancient myth describing the foundation of Rome. The two babies are Romulus and Remus, twin brothers who were abandoned at birth and suckled by the she-wolf. When they are older, Romulus kills his brother Remus after a quarrel and then founds the city of Rome, which is named after him. The image of the wolf suckling the two babies can be seen all over the city and is another ancient symbol of Rome. The largest fountain in Rome, tucked behind a palace wall, the Trevi Fountain is located where three ancient aqueducts converge. The original fountain that stood in this location was constructed by Marcus Agrippa in 19 BC, in which the Pantheon is dedicated to. The fountain as it stands today is the result of a papal contest in 1730, calling all of the most influential architects to redesign the fountain. Nicola Salvi won the design contest, and construction began in 1732, and ended after Salvi's death in 1762. The facade and sea reefs are constructed out of travertine, a limestone rock that was an extremely popular building material in ancient Rome, for the construction of monuments, aqueducts, and amphitheaters. Statues that adorn the fountain depict ocean, health, and abundance, and are sculpted from another precious Roman stone, Carrara marble. Carrara marble is native to Italy and was extremely popular in sculpture as well as construction in ancient Rome and the Renaissance period. It is said to throw a coin over one's shoulder into the fountain will bring you luck and ensure you will return to Rome. This tradition is said to have begun from ancient Romans throwing coins into fountains, lakes, and rivers for the water gods to bless their journey. The walk to our next stop is very straightforward and will bring us to the monument for Victor Emmanuel. This will be our last walk with any real length, as our last few stops will all lay within sight of one another. This might be a good time to grab a quick snack as the final part of the tour flies by. On the way, you might notice Gap, Italy, and a popular toy store named Little Big Town for those of you with little ones in tow. Sometimes affectionately referred to as the wedding cake of Italy, undergoing this stop on this tour is the National Monument for Victor Emmanuel II, completed in 1911. Constructed out of white marble next to the Capitoline Hill and standing over 20 stories high, this monument is extremely significant to Italy's more recent history. Not only a monument to the unification of Italy, inside is a museum devoted to the history of this unification. The monument is also the location of Italy's Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. 15 minutes can be spent here before continuing on to the right side of the monument where the Capitoline Hill lies.
Up these stately steps, known as the Quadrinata, lies the political center of Rome, established here for thousands of years. Overlooking the Roman Forum, and once adorned with ancient temples, the design that stands today was designed by Michelangelo himself. The mythical castle and Pollux flank the Quadrinata with horses, and at the center of the square stands a replica statue of Marcus Aurelius. From left to right, the buildings are Palazzo Nuovo, part of the Capitoline Museums, Palazzo Sanitario, the Senate of Rome, and Palazzo dei Conservatori, also a part of the Capitoline Museums. After 15 minutes, return to Il Victoriano to continue on to the Roman Forum.
For the entrance to the Roman Forum, continue about 150 feet and it will be on your right.
Filled with magnificent structures dating back to the time of Christ, the Roman Forum was the center of Rome in ancient times for politics and gatherings and is centered on the main road, Sacra Via. The first group of structures behind the Capitoline Hill consists of the Arch of Septimus Severus, the Temple of Vespasian and Titus, and the Temple of Saturn. Behind these is Curia Julia, the Senate building since converted to a church, and the Column of Focus, a Corinthian column that is the youngest structure in the Forum. Next is what remains of Basilica Aemilia, the oldest basilica in the Forum, and the Temple of Vesta, a circular temple where Rome's eternal flame was held and protected by the Vestal Virgins, young girls who were chosen to serve at the temple and remain there for 30 years. The Temple of Antonius and Faustina stands tall with columns 55 feet high and is one of the better preserved buildings in the Forum, also having been converted into a church. The Temple of Divus Romulus stands with the original door still hanging in its frame between two columns of the famous red porphyro stone, representing importance and affluence. The Basilica of Maxentius and Constantine stands over 100 feet tall and was once the largest building in the Forum. The Arch of Titus stands next to the Temple of Venus in Rome and is believed to have been the largest temple in ancient Rome and was designed by the Emperor Hadrian. The hour you spend here will afford you to witness these structures and many more, and tickets can be purchased in advance for 15.5 euro and allow entrance to the Colosseum, Roman Forum, and Palatine Museum. After exiting the Roman Forum, continue on to the Colosseum and the Arch of Constantine. Built to commemorate Constantine's victory over Maxentius in 300 BC, the Arch of Constantine stands over 80 feet high. Decorated with reliefs, friezes, and statues, the arch was constructed using artwork from older buildings, with only some of the lower friezes created specifically for the arch and the story of Constantine's victory. We have finally arrived at the last stop in our journey, the Colosseum. An extravagant ellipse where gladiators gathered, animals fought, and sea battles created, all free for everyone of every class to enjoy. Completed in just 8 years, in 80 AD, this travertine structure has a maximum capacity of 55,000 people on 4 levels and can be evacuated in 15 minutes from its 80 exits. Today, the building is riddled with holes like many of the ancient buildings in Rome, from the removal of the iron fittings once holding it together. The Colosseum also had a roof at one time, canvas supported by masts to shade the onlooking crowd. The wooden floor is partially reconstructed over cages and hallways below, once accessed by trap doors and elevators, delivering man and beast to their fate above. Once your time is spent at the Colosseum, dinner in the city of Rome awaits you, and your tour is complete. While this one-day walking tour is only a glimpse at the Eternal City, it is not likely that you will ever witness history from before Christ to the foundation of the church that he inspired, to sculpture and architecture from every century in between, all alongside exceptional food, trendsetting shops, and a rich modern history, all in a one-day, 4-mile stroll. The only question you have to ask yourself now is, where are you going to go next?
C'è la luna e mezzo mare, mamma mia, me mare da te. Figlia mia, cotta dure, mamma mia, te pensa tu. Si tu rulla gangare, e dov'è, e dove ne siamo usati, c'è manetene. Se ti piace i maccheroni, mi piace spaghetti pure.